or to the fetuses, because if it is a multiple pregnancy, how we can make a difference? So why I am talking about is that the critical periods of development of the fetus, I will try to speak in layman's language, is that the first 3 months of pregnancy, that is within 10 to 12 weeks after conception. So a normal pregnancy, if you all know, it goes up to 40 weeks, right? So, I saw somebody nodding, so I think I'm a little bit, you're able to understand what I'm saying. So the first 10 to 12 weeks are what are most crucial, because that is the time the baby's organs are developing. Right, so all the major systems are developing. So it is at that time that we must ensure that the right kind of environment is provided to this growing fetus. And if it is not, it will result, maybe it will result in an anomaly, maybe it will result in a malformation, maybe it will result in growth retardation. So the idea of a fetal medicine specialist is we start working preconceptionally. We start working even before the mother becomes pregnant, because the burden of the disease is such that you would find that almost we are losing 270,000 newborns which are born within the first 28 days of life because of certain malformations. And which are the commonest malformations? These are the heart defects, the spinal defects, and Down syndrome, you may have all heard of. It is basically the most common cause of mental retardation in our country or in the world itself, right? So these are the three major conditions. Are we able to prevent them? Are we able to screen for them? And are we able to treat them? So that is a big, big area into which we are looking into. Because like I said, the burden of disease is such that babies are born undiagnosed. Many of them are diagnosed after birth. The mother may have been on certain treatment which has affected the baby. So these are various children which are born with, you know, embryopathies because the mother has taken certain unmonitored drugs during her pregnancy, or they are born with certain defects. So the major causes of birth defects, 50% of them are not known. It may be certain drugs, it may be obesity, it may be diabetes, it may be because she's been exposed to maybe radiation or to pesticides. And maybe at times due to consanguinity, where there is a genetic relationship between both the partners. So my work as a fetal medicine specialist begins preconceptionally. So what is preconception? So at preconceptionally, we are trying to look at certain interventions so that we can identify and modify the biomedical, the behavioral, and the social risks to a woman's health or pregnancy. So it is our question is that don't come to us when you are pregnant. Come to us before you plan your pregnancy. So there are various barriers to this kind of screening. You know, most of the population, I don't know how many amongst you would know that it is so very important to access your healthcare. You know, it is not to come to the healthcare when you have developed a complication. It is so very important to come prior to that. And even from the provider aspect, you would see that maybe there is still a lack of knowledge, a lack of awareness. How should we work in this arena? So there are three components of preconceptional care. One is to identify what is wrong, then to counsel that this is wrong with you and how I can intervene, or you know, I can modify that process, right? So these are the three, and our objective is that we should have a healthy woman before she becomes a healthy mother. Okay, so as obstetrician and gynecologist, this is what we are providing, and of course we have a multitude of others who are supporting us. At Safdarjung Hospital, we also have what is known as a NEEV clinic. So this is basically a premarital screening clinic where even before marriage, young couples are encouraged to come for counseling. Okay, so this is where when they come for counseling, there are certain history of certain disorders, genetic disorders or family disorder history is taken, and they are investigated for certain major diseases. You know, so this is done, and also genetic counseling is undertaken, which means that we ask them that are there any birth defects in the family? Is there a child who is hearing impaired? Is there a child who has vision impairment? Is there somebody who has a learning disability, you know, or there is a developmental disability? So all those things we inquire into, and finally before the lady or the person is planning marriage or conception, there are various tests that we do for major disorders, and we counsel them that now you are perfectly fine, or if you are not, this is what you need to do before you plan your pregnancy. So once the pregnancy has happened, yeah, once the lady comes to us, so another thing which happens in our country is that most women come to us when already the pregnancy is 3 months old. You know, they are already 3 to 4 months pregnant because they think that first 3 months are not so essential. The more number of markers that I can test for, the more better my results become, the lesser is my error and the better is my result. So there are certain FOCSI guidelines. So what is FOCSI? FOCSI is a professional body of obstetrics and gynecologists, Federation of Obs Gyne Society in India. So we have certain guidelines that when a lady comes to you in the first trimester, please screen and decide, is this lady in the high risk category? Is this lady in intermediate or is she a low risk? So if she is a low risk woman, she goes into the regular obstetric care. But if she is high risk, she will definitely need many more tests, right? So what are these tests? So these are various other biochemical markers which can be done, which are done in the second trimester. These are other chemicals which are tested in the woman's body. And by looking at the second trimester quadruple and the dual markers, and by looking at the second trimester ultrasound, I can confirm that this baby will be a normal fetus. So a second trimester scan, again, as I said, this is a very specialized scan which should be done by a fetal medicine specialist because it looks for certain soft markers. So a general radiologist who will do a scan will tell you, fine, these are the larger parts are fine. But there are certain things which are known as soft markers, which you have to actually look for when you do the scan. And these soft markers are what are going to determine whether this fetus is at risk for any genetic defect. So these are various soft markers. These are certain images which we look into and we decide that what is the risk to this pregnancy, right? So other than an ultrasound, and please remember, other than the biochemical screen, there is another very important test, and I think many of you may have heard of it, is the non-invasive prenatal test, which is the NIPT. Right? So what is the NIPT doing? The NIPT is checking for the genetic defect in the baby from the mother's blood. It is a very advanced technology. You are taking the mother's blood and you are putting it through a series of tests. And these tests are known as, maybe you are doing a massive parallel sequencing or you are doing an SNP based array. You may not be very familiar with these words, but they tell you that this is the mother's chromosome and that is the fetal chromosome. And they are able to tell you that, fine, this baby's chromosome is normal. That is a non-invasive test. Fine, that is anybody who can advise for and get it done. But what does a fetal medicine specialist do? So fetal medicine specialist role comes in when you find that the fetus has a problem. So the fetus may have various kinds of problems. There might be fetal tumors. So this is a case of a tumor which is inside the baby's heart. So this is an ultrasound image which is showing you the tumor which is inside the baby's heart. So what do? So it is very important that whenever you see a baby, whenever we see a baby who has a problem, we have to screen the parents also. Because we are looking at certain things. Is it genetically inherited, right? Or is it a certain infection that the mother may have contracted which has led to this kind of fluid collection inside the brain? Or, you know, is it something, a baby has a cardiac defect which maybe even the mother is carrying a defect, we don't know. So as a result, we are not just treating the baby, we are treating the mother also. And like in this case, we have a case of a congenital heart block. So you look at the ultrasound and you look at the heart and you see that it is a very slow heart. This is a baby which has a congenital heart block. And why? Because the mother was carrying certain antibodies which had affected the baby's heart. So this is a very, very, you know, skilled thing which is going right into the checking the fetus, looking at it and diagnosing it. And helping us to do so is a 3D scan or a 4D scan. So in a 3D or a 4D scan, actually you can look at the baby's face, you can make out the eyes, the nose, the mouth, and if there are any defects. So these are faces of babies who are carrying some chromosomal defect. These are not normal babies. And other than that, we have an ultra-fast MRI. Now, these are basically all diagnostic procedures which are non-invasive. Now, I come to certain procedures which we do, which are known as the amniocentesis, which is known as the chorionic villus sampling or the cordocentesis. So maybe some of you may have heard of these terminologies. So amniocentesis is to check the amniotic fluid which is present around the baby, and that gives us a lot of knowledge because amniotic fluid belongs to the baby. It doesn't belong to the mother, it comes from the baby. So the cells which are present in the amniotic fluid, so my job is to look at that amniotic fluid, is to go inside, ultrasound guided, go inside the sac, take out the fluid and send it for testing, right? So either take out the fluid or take out a part of the chorionic villus, which is take out a part of the placenta. So these are all belonging to the fetus. So whenever we do these kind of tests, these are known as prenatal diagnostic tests. These tests are done on the unborn fetus. So these are prenatal tests. Before the baby is born, we are testing the fluid around the baby, or we are testing the part of the placenta which is supplying the baby. Now, we've decided that this baby has a problem. Okay, so we are able to diagnose that this baby has a problem. So then the next role, my next role is fetal therapy. How do I treat this baby before it is born? Right? So in the mother's womb, can I do something to help this baby? So fetal therapy is basically intervention for the purpose of correcting or treating a fetal anomaly or condition. So over the last 30 years, many developments have occurred. I mean, you wouldn't think maybe 30 years back that if this baby has a problem, can I do something before the baby is born? In the last 30 years, there have been many developments. There have been, of course, it's still like India here, we are not so much of, you know, advanced, and that we are still probably copying the West because they are doing far better things than we are doing, but we are in the process of catching up with them. So there are various So the fetal therapy means that either the fetus is carrying certain lethal anomalies. What does lethal anomaly mean? Lethal means that this baby will not survive even if it is born. So in certain lethal anomalies, termination of pregnancy can be advised. But the law says, and the rule in India is, that you can terminate a pregnancy only before 20 weeks. So after 20 weeks, it is illegal. And you may have heard, read in the newspapers at times, you may have heard about cases where the women, because they were carrying malformed babies, have gone to court because it's an advanced pregnancy, but then the court has to come into it and there are certain legal formalities. But before 20 weeks, the woman herself can take a decision that I am carrying a baby with a lethal anomaly, so I should go in for termination. Now, there are certain anomalies which are treatable at birth. So we monitor the baby and then we deliver and then we treat. While there are certain which can be treated inside the womb. So today I'm going to talk about process therapies which we do when the baby is still inside the womb. So there are non-invasive and invasive. Non-invasive means we are not touching the uterus or we're not touching the fetus. So what are we doing? How are we going to treat? So we are going to give the drugs to the mother. And from the mother's blood, transplacentally, the drug will go to the fetus. So that is a non-invasive. While what is invasive, that we going into the uterus and we are going to directly treat the fetus. So is that clear? So there are two types. So when I talk about non-invasive, I talk about therapeutic, which means I treat, and I talk about preventive, which means I prevent. So coming to preventive first, preventive means that I want to prevent certain diseases from occurring in the baby. So it is like, if you have heard of an HIV positive mother who is carrying a fetus, it is so very important for her to be put on heart, which means a highly active antiretroviral therapy, right? So that the HIV virus will not pass from the mother to the fetus, okay? So that is preventive. I'm preventing an infection. What about giving corticosteroids? So corticosteroids are certain drugs which help in fetal lung maturity. So if I'm going to deliver a baby at 8 months or at 7 months, the baby has immature lungs. So I'm going to give corticosteroids to the mother so that the baby's lungs become mature and I have a better baby when the baby is delivered. So these are certain therapies like stem cell, IVIG. These are things which are going to prevent. Now, what is therapeutic? Therapeutic means the disease is already there. I have to treat it. Okay. So what are the kind of diseases which I can treat? So it is infections. If the mother is carrying certain infections which can pass to the fetus, like rubella, like toxoplasma. So I have to treat those. Then if the fetus itself has certain problems, like what? Like if fetus has a heart problem, its heart rate is very high or its heart rate is very low. It is having that problem, or it is having some metabolic disorder, or the baby has a thyroid problem. So I can treat all those things without disturbing the pregnancy. So this is basically all our drug therapy. So I will not go into the details of the various drugs because this will become like not really very, you won't be able to relate to it that way. So there are certain drugs which we can give if the baby's heart rate is very high. Say it is here in this case we had, it was 240. Normal is around 140. So this baby was treated with drugs. And finally, this baby went home with a normal heart rate of 122. So these are increased heart rates or slower hearts. So we are treating slower hearts with steroids, we are treating them with salbutamol, different kind of drugs. So like fetal hypothyroidism, I'll quickly rush through this. So if the fetus has a thyroid problem, what are we doing? We can even give the mother the drug, or we can inject the drug in the fluid which is present around the baby, which is known as an intra-amniotic injection. Okay. So in these conditions, in hyperthyroidism. So these are various conditions where I am treating the baby by non-invasive method. And what, when coming to the invasive therapy, because this is what is very, very highly skilled field of medicine, where invasive therapy comes in, that can I treat this fetus without causing the pregnancy to abort, right? Or can I treat this fetus without causing harm to the baby? So in an invasive therapy, and this is something which I will come to, I mean, this is something which, like, a baby can have problem in any of the systems, right? It can be a cardiac problem, it can be a problem in the fetal urinary bladder, it can be a problem in the fetal chest or thorax. So there are various conditions which I need to treat. And something which we are very commonly doing, and something I think we should all be aware of as lay persons, is that there is a condition known as fetal anemia, which means the fetus is having less hemoglobin. And how does that happen? That very commonly happens to a mother who is Rh negative. Means if the mother's blood group is negative, she may be A negative, B negative, O negative, and she is married to a person who is positive. So what is happening is that the mother is carrying antibodies to the positive. And if the fetus is positive, the mother's antibodies are destroying the baby's blood. Right? So the baby is becoming anemic right inside the uterus. Can we do something about it? So one is that when we test, we do a certain type of special ultrasound, which is known as the MCA Doppler, to detect that yes, this baby is anemic, this baby needs blood. There is another procedure that we do is in monochorionic twin pregnancies. What is a monochorionic twin? Not very difficult to understand. It is a twin, which means there are two babies, but they have a common placenta. You understand? Placenta, which supplies the blood and the nutrition to the baby. So we have one placenta, but we have two babies who are sharing the placenta. So what is happening? So there can be a stage, not in every pregnancy, but in certain pregnancies, one baby will take larger share of the placenta and the other baby will remain smaller. So what is happening is that one baby is taking away. This is known as twin to twin transfusion, which means one baby is getting more blood, the other baby is not growing. So this is known as TGTS, which is a very common complication of monochorionic pregnancy, where you are sharing one placenta. So what should we do in this case? Any suggestions? So what is the treatment option? So between the two babies, there is one placenta. So I have to divide the placenta. So I have to enter into the uterus with a fetoscope. A fetoscope is an endoscope. You have heard about endoscopic surgeries. So fetoscope is an endoscope with which we go inside the uterus. We locate the placenta and we divide it so that both the fetuses will get an equal share, right? That's what. So this is, you're going through a fetoscope. So you can see there are various vessels. Can you see? There are various vessels which I can see through the fetoscope. So I have to first identify which vessel, because I have to cut the placenta, so I have to coagulate. So which vessel should I coagulate? So once after I have identified is when I go in with a laser. So what is this laser? This is an ND-YAG laser. And basically the laser coagulates these vessels. So if you can see here. So can you see the red dots which are coming? That is the laser. So the laser will go in and it will coagulate the vessels. So whichever, because the vessels are shared, so we are dividing them. Okay. So once we have divided, what has happened? So each baby will get its own share. Okay. So that is a fetoscopic guided procedure. This is done in very few centers in India. It is of course very commonly done outside India, but very few centers here in India. And I trained in AIIMS, Delhi. So it is being done there also. So further. So another case is, like I said, it can be either both the twins are sharing and they are not getting enough. So we have divided and we have given equal share to both. Or it can be that one twin has become so small that it is no longer viable. So in a monochorionic pregnancy, another complication which occurs is a fetal growth retardation. One baby has become so small that it will not survive. But out of the two babies, if one dies, what will happen? So the other baby, the blood from the other baby will shunt to the dying baby. The dying baby will try to take the blood from the living. So we have to prevent that shunting, because what is happening, then both twins will die, right? So in order to save one, then we need to coagulate the cord of that twin, which is anyway going to die. So this is another procedure which is known as a radio frequency ablation that we do, which means we again enter with a radio RFN needle and we try to identify the dying twin, which is anyway, so it might sound a bit morbid to you that, you know, I'm talking of all these things, but that is the medical practice is all about. You try to save at least one, right? So we go in with the needle, we try to identify the cord of that dying twin and we coagulate that cord. So at least that one twin then will then survive, okay? So this is known as RFA procedure. This is also something that we frequently need to do. And there are various others. I think I have taken a bit longer. Is it time? Okay. So there are various other things which we also do. I thought that we can tell you about fetal reduction. If there is a lady, especially there is so much of IVF going on, you know, so there are women who will come with 4 embryos. They will come with 5 embryos. And if you let them be, then none of them will survive. So fetal reduction is another procedure. We will try to identify the smaller embryo, which will otherwise also not survive, so that the woman goes back with just 2. You know, so that then she can continue with her pregnancy. Because any pregnancy more than 2, many complications to the mother and to the babies also. So that is fetal reduction which we do. Then I'll quickly go through this. This is like the baby. This baby was having lower urinary tract obstruction, which means the baby's bladder was filling up with urine. It did not have the passage to go out. So what can we do in this condition? In this condition, we can put in a shunt. Right, it is a small pigtail catheter, a shunt. Again, everything is ultrasound guided because you are not going inside, you know. So you are looking with the ultrasound, you are putting the catheter. So I think, I don't know about medical equipment, but of course we are using a lot of equipments here. I don't know what BIS's interest would be in this, but definitely, so we are putting in a pigtail catheter. And the catheter ensures that the urine goes out of the bladder into the amniotic cavity. So in that way, we have relieved the obstruction. So when the baby comes out, then a laser coagulation is done and the obstruction is relieved. So likewise, the baby may have tumors in the thorax, right? So these are CPAM, CCAM, there are various tumors. They are treated with various methods, by laser, by giving drugs, or by open surgeries also. So I'll just finish with my take home message that all pregnancies should be planned after preconception counseling and screening. Expectant mothers should undergo screening for common chromosomal disorders and any congenital malformation in the unborn baby. Fetal medicine specialists should be consulted regarding any high-risk condition of the mother which can affect the baby or any disorder detected in the unborn fetus. So fetus can be treated through non-invasive transplacental methods, while certain fetal conditions require intrauterine management, while some can be treated ex utero, that is exit. Fetoscopic and image-guided surgeries have fewer maternal complications. If you do open, of course, definitely more complications compared to closed surgeries. But open fetal surgeries still have a significant role in malformations like myelomeningocele. The trends are changing from open surgery to minimal invasive. Like in adults, we are doing minimal invasive, similarly for the fetus. Maternal safety is always the prime concern. The mother always comes first. And fetal interventions, when performed in experienced hands and well-equipped settings, are safe. So, thank you. So, I can take it.